on the tape recorder over here, so we're all set. I think we can, we're going to go a little bit out of sequence we thought we were going to do, but I think the first thing we might do is show the slides that Tim Sawyer brought tonight, and that will give us an overview of some kind of overview of what we might see, give a visual image of what his experience, some of his experience was like, and then we'll go to the regular formal part of the program. So let's start with these slides, and I'm going to run the projector, and Tim's going to stand up front and give us the blow-by-blow account here, so we'll see how this goes.
See, a picture's worth 1,000 words. I've got 42,000 words right here that we can dispense with quickly.
Let's see.
This was me. I took ROTC at the University of Maine, and was commissioned as second lieutenant in 1969, and went into the Army. I went to the Armored Officers Basic at Fort Knox, Kentucky. And I was in the 2nd Armored Division in Fort Hood, Texas, where my oldest son was born at Maine. I was in an advisory team capacity in Vietnam, and in the early days of advisory teams, they were drawn from units that might already be there. And then in 1969, they started assigning directly from the United States, so I was assigned directly from Fort Hood, Texas, to an advisory team in Vietnam. And before I went to the advisory team, I had to go to jungle school in Panama, at Fort Sherman, Panama, Belgium. Anyway, that's Cumberland Hall, University of Maine, June 1969. Newly met a second lieutenant, naive, and ready to go. While I was in jungle school in Panama, my oldest son was born. This went home on 30 days leave before leaving for Vietnam. This is my 19-year-old wife at the time. I was the oldest son. So that gave you something to think about when you had nothing else to think about. Fort Sherman, Panama Canal Zone. This was the free pass. We didn't see this, I think, when we arrived and when we left. The rest of it was all jungle. Mind your wife's too. When I first went to Vietnam, I went to a rudimentary language and weapons school, and then was sent to the place that I spent my entire tour. This was the compound. Can you look that up, Mr. Hairstand? Anyways, this is a regional force company compound. I was on a mobile advisory team, which was supposed to be a captain, a first lieutenant, two sergeants, and an interpreter. We lived in this bunker here, underground, and the Vietnamese commander lived in this bunker. That was the, and you can see, you're looking at 50% of the compound there. These mountains to the north went up about 4,000 feet. It was really very beautiful. South Vietnamese flag, obviously, and radio control. This is a view of twilight, a little bit better view of the bunker we lived in. See, what they must have been below ground level, and the range of usually a buck on the top would be in water. Rats would run around there. No matter what holds up, the rat went down there on the face. Pretty primitive camping. You see? Another view of the same compound looking to the towards Saigon, and these were some mountains down that way. It was inland from the ocean in a plain in the ocean mountains. Now this is out on a camping excursion with the Vietnamese commanders, and this is when I first was over there, and I weighed about 200 pounds, and was pretty fit. When I came home, I weighed 135 pounds. That was at the beginning of the war, and I was still belly up. This is the main highway of Vietnam. QL1, this would be the MAT team I was on. This fellow was from Vermont. This guy was from the Carolinas, and there's one more American up here. That was the MAT team. We were the regional force company here. This was the medic. We got injured. We had to rely on a South Vietnamese medic. And towards the end of the tour, it was a medevac. Here's a medevac. It was 45 minutes away. So we got her we had 27 regional and popular forces that we were supposed to be coordinating with, and this was one. We lived in that other compound. We were going to move into this compound. We were starting to build an above ground bunker here. And then the mission changed, and it was the American Engineer Battalion was going to rebuild that main highway, and we had to coordinate security of the highway with the engineer and the maintenance units that we were providing. It's another shot of the bunker. This was the commander of that unit, Lieutenant Dan, and his sergeant. And they were North Vietnamese Catholics that had come to South Vietnam and escaped from the execution. They were probably the best unit we had in there. This is the commanding general 2-4, Charles Brown, awarding a medal to one of the Vietnamese soldiers. He devised a way to booby trap night ambush claymores. And I'll take a second here. When these Viet Cong, and they call arrow action teams, would come into the villages and try to assassinate village officials at night. And so the job of these units would be to try to deny them access to the villages. And the Viet Cong, the point man, would be stripped down to almost no clothing. They go along in the dock and they feel for these fish line booby trap wires across the paths. It was set up with be like two pieces of metal, and it would be a radio battery, and you'd have electric blasting cap and a claymore. When the lead man hit the wire, it would pull the two pieces of metal together, and that would set off the claymore. Well, by stripping down so they wore no clothing, they could walk along slowly. They'd feel the trip line, like you feel a spider web on your face, they'd feel it anywhere on the body. And they'd cut the line, and then they'd follow the line back and take the claymore. So the ambush, not only would the ambush be failed, but they'd gain a claymore on the thing. This guy that he's giving the medal to had designed a three metal prong booby trap claymore so that if you went into the wire and didn't feel it, we'd pull one side over and you'd make contact and it would set off the blasting cap. But if they felt it and they cut the line, the other one was spring loaded, it would go over. And they never were able to defeat that, and that's when they started to have more success and more name than the prongs. This is the sergeant who's newly in his medal, and these stakes are what they put stakes in the ground on off the side of the trails, and that's what would set off the claymore. Okay. This is a L-19 bird dog from Florida, Controller, and we had a little incident. I was laying on my back, I called for air support, and this guy came, and nothing happened after while he flew around, and as soon as he left it. We spent a day doing nothing but kind of catching people in there. Inland, the railroad, you have the coast, then you have the main highway, then you have the railroad, and this was the railroad. It was in, up in Moonline, and they had General Electric locomotives. The railroad had been destroyed on both ends of the towns, but we'd have to provide road security so they could bring diesel fuel in, fuel the locomotives, so they could ride back and forth. One put down the other. They had a whole railroad company that guarded these trains. So when we won the war, the trains would be intact and they could rebuild the railroad and take off again. This is the typical countryside. And everybody sees the Vietnam films with the jungle, but the area that we were in was actually quite arid. I think the monsoon season was ending when I got there in September, and by November it didn't rain. I came home in June and it hadn't rained since. This is just one of the communities we were taking a walk through. Everybody was a farmer. This is having a rice spread out in front. This guy would be a local farmer. That's the highway we didn't control. The Vietnam was off the bus, take everybody off, and they got an ID, they executed them on the spot. school teachers, policemen, any soldier, any government official, they have all shared their IDs and they put it together and that's when they go. Again, this is Highway 1, it's a B100 armed car with myself being the east, down the base from the district there. That was the last, that was the, that bridge would be the last place we controlled, and the highway was in no man's land, down below that, but somebody else took it over. We had Jeeps that were, you know, the American made Jeeps, but the Vietnamese, we were assigned to the Vietnamese, they were supposed to maintain them, but I found the maintenance less than satisfactory, so I built my own maintenance bay, and had my father send me over to grease gun, and I scrubbed the grease and the pipes, and I ended up changing the transmission and the wheelbarrow, so I didn't need to fill them again. That's just the hands-on district headquarters in Bethel. That's the work area that the Jeep put in. Hi, John Kerry, got people to take pictures of him, I take my own time on it. This is a picture of the South China Sea, near Fantiat, big cliffs, with a naval dock down here. When I was growing up and I worked in North Waterford for Arctic Brown, you know, we had concrete, ready-mixed concrete and paving products, so I was fascinated by this. I'd run the crusher several summers. This was how they segregated the aggregate. They had a board in their hand that looked like a paint palette, and they had different size holes. And they went around the stream bed and they picked up each rock and tried it in the hole, and fit the hole, they walked over and put it in the pile. that was how they produced aggregate. American engineers were going to rebuild Highway 1. We had to go with them, and this was overlooked part of the highway. And so that's a D7 with it's got two seats, one for the operator, one for the guy riding shotgun, and I'm a personnel carrier. And we went up with them and took control of this high ground and spent the night before they could send people down to have a little bit of a fire base on top of the hill. This is a view from the top of that hill looking towards Saigon. Pretty rugged country, pretty beautiful country. This was near Fantiat, which is now a big recreation area, but at the time it wasn't. And this is where they brought the Chu Hoi program. That's where if you were a Vietnam, you could surrender. And they bring you in here and re-educate you and give you medical treatment, get you fattened up, and then they turn you loose and go back and join the Vietnam unit. This fellow here is from Lancaster, New Hampshire. I see him occasionally. His whole advisory team and mine were combined for the end of our tour, and then we disbanded when we pulled BHS to Hampstead. Physical scene near the ocean. These are people self-defense force. Being trained in the use of rifles, the theory was that try to deny Viet Cong access into the villages, if they train the villagers to defend themselves, because the Viet Cong were coming at night and they had a village, or a hamlet chief. They were terrorists, and they were more specific than terrorists we are fighting today. They would pinpoint the village chief, or hamlet chief, and usually his family. And I remember we went to one village one time where everybody was still crying. They'd been in the previous night, and they built a bonfire, brought up all the villagers at gunpoint, stood up there and brought up the village chief and his wife and three children, and they started by executing the youngest child, each one up until they got the other. That's why they were trying to get these people to be able to defend themselves. That's the information, and a little loggy background. This was the log trucks. What it is, it's an old army truck with the windshield down, and these two guys are set out front yelling directions. The driver's back in behind the firewall, he can't see, he's down underneath the log, and they're telling him whether to turn right, left, stop, or go. So when you saw one of those coming, you think the log truck's here dangerous, you want to get out of the road, one of those, relying on these two guys, you got to yell at the guy in behind the seat. Okay. Here's one of those logs that's been delivered to the sawmill. What it is there's a fishing fleet in Fantiette, an armed fishing fleet. What dictated the length of the boats, that was the length of the logs they could bring in. And I had some pictures that never came out with my camera craft out, of building the boat. Build the framework, and then they have these planks along the side, and they have the bow drills where you put the piece on your chest and go like this and drill a hole, and they peg them. So you've got the frame of a boat with these straight planks along the side, then they put all the brush under it, light it on fire. While it's burning, that would heat up the wood, and they'd bring them around, and they'd all be pre-drilled, and they'd peg them, and then they'd put the fire out, and the fire would have charred the wood, and the charred wood would retard the growth of barnacles. So they don't want to be using the wood, but also to give it the zinc if they don't know. That's a French-made sawmill. Why they could saw any length timbers is just depending on the length of the rails. The log was pinned to the ground, and this would be a horizontal bandsaw, and it could be pushed down on the rails. And then this could be jacked up and down on these side pieces, so they push it down, pull it back, lower it an inch, push it down, bring it back. And that's what ran the carriage, was they pushed it through the log, and the engine was right on. If any of you know Dale Sanborn Sawmill Machinery in Waterford, that's what gave him his idea for his first portable mill, was at the same time these mills in the town. That's the sawmill from Great Distance. And this is the more primitive sawmill. It's what you call a pit saw, so you have one guy up, one guy down. Now, we went on an all-day operation where we went by this village in the morning, and I took a picture. And I came back at night, and I took another picture. And you hold the two pictures up, and they look identical. That's the type of production. I think that's my last photo. That's when my camera crapped out. Thank you.
Okay, on this Veterans Day, I'd like to welcome everybody here and just make a few introductory remarks and go from there. The Vietnam era was one of the most controversial times in American history. The recent presidential campaign revived some of those controversies that have been the subject of debates for many years. Despite the passage of 40 years since the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution of 1954, authorized U.S. involvement in Southeast Asia, little has changed to dampen the passions of the war has aroused. For many years, the society has collected oral histories of particular events and subjects. We have had sessions dedicated to many topics, including the Great Depression, farming, logging, World War II, the Korean conflict, among others. On this Veterans Day evening, we will focus on the Vietnam War. It is hoped that a public discussion of this experience may shed some light on the war and gather some of the perspectives of those in the area who served. I'd like to thank the panel. Dick Farron, would you raise your hand like all people off? Don Clanton, Tim Sawyer, Don Feeney, Al Cressy, John Davis, Errol Briggs, and last but not least, Richard Grove. So, for joining us tonight. We have some questions that were sent in advance of this gathering. We'll be in comments and questions from the audience as we move through the evening. We have an exhibit in the rear and over here on the side of some of the artifacts and ephemera of that period. Bethel lost three men associated with the town in Vietnam. Jim Bartlett and Ron Smiley grew up here and graduated from Gould, but did not live here when they entered the service of Vietnam. In my sophomore year in college, probably in the spring of 1964, I was pleasantly surprised when I got up and found that Jim Bartlett, a friend of one of my roommates, had spent the night. He was one of the nicest of all people I ever knew, and we had a great chat about home. I never saw him again. Ran Smiley was on the kitchen staff at Korean Camp in Lake Montgomery, Ontario, when I was ran the camp store. He loved everything military, and wore his hair short and fatigues most of the summer. I never saw him again either. Carl Churchill never lived in Bethel, but his father taught at Gould. He died when his aircraft was shot down, but his remains were never found. The stretch of highway on Route 26 below the village is now named for him. To provide a very brief overview of the war, I've asked Brad Clark, Regis History at Gould, Reference at Gould, to give us a little overview of the Vietnam War. And without further ado, here's Brad Clark, who holds a doctorate from Brandeis University. Is that right, Brad?
Right, thank you.
Brad Clark.
Thank you very much for having me today, and thank you to the veterans who served during the war. It's an honor for me to be here tonight to give a little perspective from the historian's perspective about the war. Certainly the Vietnam War is something that still resonates today. As Stan said, certainly was an issue we saw in the presidential campaign. Our minds on this day, I think, go out to veterans everywhere and to service people who were over in Iraq and over in Afghanistan. My brother just shipped out a few days ago to the Middle East to Qatar. He's going to be over there for the next year or so. So certainly those folks are on our mind tonight. I'll just kind of briefly try and give people some context to think about the Vietnam War. I'm someone who was born in 1967, so obviously I wasn't there when it was happening. Stan asked me to just give you kind of a chronological overview. I thought that it would be useful to start thinking about the Vietnam War in 1945. Period of U.S. involvement in Vietnam didn't come until later, but there's some important early history in terms of understanding the reasons why the United States got involved. Of course, the greater context for the Vietnam War was the Cold War. And the Cold War is a period of hostility between the Soviet Union and the United States that followed after World War II. At the close of World War II, the Soviet Union and the United States entered this period of Cold War. The United States became very concerned about communist aggression in different parts of the world. During the 1940s and 1950s, countries like Korea, countries like Vietnam, became the battlefields on which the Cold War was fought. To kind of set stage for Vietnam, it's important to remember that before the United States was involved in Vietnam, the French were involved in Vietnam. The French were involved fighting in Vietnam from 1946 until 1954. And finally, in 1954, the French were defeated in a battle named Dinh Diem Phu, and the French signed the Geneva Accords with Vietnam and decided to partition the country along the middle. At that point, the United States became more involved, and as the 1950s turned into the 1960s with the election of John F. Kennedy, Kennedy's policy turned towards placing military advisors in Vietnam. I wasn't sure, I didn't catch the date when you wrote there.
It was there from September 70 to June 79.
Okay, so it wasn't from 1970.
It was late.
Yeah. In the early 60s, the United States began to send a number of military advisors over to the country. When I saw the slides that Tim showed, I thought perhaps that he had been sent over quite early in the war as one of the military advisors, but it turns out it's quite late in the war. Kennedy, as we know, didn't live to see the end of his presidency. He was assassinated in 1963 in Dallas. When Kennedy was assassinated, just several weeks before that, the leader of South Vietnam was also assassinated, President Tin Anh. And that marked a real change in U.S. policy towards Vietnam. The new president, President Johnson, began to escalate the war in Vietnam. Stan mentioned the Tonkin Gulf incident and the Tonkin Gulf resolutions in the summer of 1964 really marked the approval of Congress to authorize the president to use force in Vietnam. And as 1964 turned into 1965, we began to see U.S. military forces being sent over to Vietnam in large numbers. And President Johnson commenced a bombing campaign on his own thunder. Familiar with, thinking that that this kind of air campaign in the north could possibly force the Viet Cong, the North Vietnamese, into submission. As the middle 60s turn into the late 60s, things get more complicated in Vietnam. 1968 is a real turning point. A lot of the historians who look at the war see 68 as a real turning point, as Tet Offensive happened in 1968. American public opinion starts to, in many cases, turn against the war in 1968. There's the famous newscaster Walter Cronkite went over to Vietnam in 68 in the wake of the Tet Offensive and came back and gave a number of reports to the American public that what was going on over there wasn't exactly the same as what the public was being told by the president and by the generals. And at that point, we began to see a lot of anti-war protests along different college campuses throughout the country. 68 was also, think of some of the worst years in American history. 1968 probably ranks up there. The assassination of Robert Kennedy, the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr., very tumultuous year. 68 really, as I said, marked a turning point in terms of the sense of the American public, whether the war was being won or whether the war was being lost. There's some irony in that Tet Offensive, as judged by the U.S. military forces and by the U.S. Military leadership, was a defeat for the Viet Cong. It was a defeat for Ho Chi Minh on the ground. If you look at the number of casualties suffered by the Viet Cong and the North Vietnamese, it would seem as if the United States was victorious in the battle, but the Tet Offensive had a broader, I guess the effect of the Tet Offensive in the media began to, a lot of the American public began to question whether the U.S. was winning in the war. And if for Ho Chi Minh, it was a battle that the Vietnamese lost on the ground. It was probably a psychological or a moral success for them. And so the Tet Offensive was really kind of the turning point in the war. The war in 1970, 1971 gets widened as President Johnson leaves in 68 and President Nixon comes in. He promises a new policy in Vietnam. He promises a policy of peace with honor. Nixon promises to sort of de-escalate the war his phrase was to bring about Vietnamization of the war, replace U.S. troops with Vietnamese troops. What Nixon also didn't tell the American public at first was he was going to go into Laos and go into Cambodia. And so Nixon, during the early 70s, widened the war, which also, when that was broadcast in the media, that had other ramifications in terms of public opinion about the war. And as the early 70s progressed, the United States began to negotiate peace talks in Paris, and in 1975 marks the end of the war when Saigon fell, and in the following months the North Vietnamese moved into South Vietnam. And so it's to really understand the Vietnam conflict, it's important to think about this period from 1945 to 1975. It was a 30-year period of conflict in the country. While it would seem on its face to have been one of the wars during the Cold War that the United States lost, it is also important to remember that ultimately the United States was successful in the Cold War in defeating the Soviet Union. And the Soviet Union did, as China did, Communist China, pour a lot of resources into Vietnam. And some historians of the Cold War argue that the fact that the Soviet Union had to pour a lot of supplies and money into Vietnam ultimately weakened it and helped bring about the demise of the Soviet Union in the early 1990s. Certainly, the later war in Afghanistan in the 1980s did a lot to weaken the Soviet Union as well. So, for me, I just wanted to give you a sense of a broader picture of the war, think about the Cold War. When I talk to my students, high school students now, you talk about the Cold War, and a lot of them, to me, someone who grew up in the midst of the Cold War or something. present in my life. And our students today are, you know, are very accustomed to hear about the war in terror and the war in Iraq, but they hear about the Cold War and the Soviet Union, and they, you know, that's not even a country anymore. What's so it's so Vietnam to a lot of students today is a place far away and a long time ago. And I guess my job as a teacher is to try and to bring them to the war, to try and appreciate a lot of the complexities to the war and a lot of the sacrifices that the people involved in the war had to endure. And I wish I could have brought some students tonight. Unfortunately, we have a Mahusik Arts presentation over in the Bingham Auditorium, and it's a mandatory assembly for the students over there. Otherwise, I had some students who were very excited about coming here, so I'm just excited to be able to sit down and hear from some of you folks about the war, so thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Brad, to do a job that quickly and all that history in such a short time. I think now we can go on to our panel now, and this is what we've all been waiting to hear. And we will start with the questions and go over each one, and start maybe over with Rich Grover, and ask him what branch you served in, and were you drafted, or you did enlist? And what branch did you achieve? You got the first question, no matter those three questions.
Well, I was in the Air Force, and I wasn't drafted because I've been in since 1959, and I went to Vietnam in 67. So I've been through an aviation cadet program and became a navigator and then an electronic warfare officer. And I actually, in early December of 1966, volunteered to go to Vietnam because I'd been flying in B-52s and in the back with no windows, with just my electronic gear, messing with radar signals and stuff like that, not being able to see out much, and I was looking for a change of scenery. So I volunteered to go over there, and as the good doctor was saying, at that time, it sounded like it was a good thing to do. The communists were, it looked like they were taking over the world. China had gone communist, North Korea, Cuba had gone communist, Indonesia was communist under Suharto, and there were communist insurgencies in South America. It looked like, you know, the feeling a lot of us in the military was better to fight them over there than wait till they come across the Mexican border. So at the time I was in Vietnam, I was a captain, and that's my flight suit there that I ended up surviving my tour.
Thank you. Go on.
Can I do this thing?
Yes,
now?
Yeah,
no,
that's
good.
Just speak up so everyone can hear. So.
Well, I was Air Force, and I was not drafted either. I, like Rich, I was an aviation cadet. Went in 1960, and went through NAV school and went to the C-130 as a tactical airline navigator in 1961. Got sidetracked into a one-year project involving testing nuclear weapons down in the South Pacific, which was very interesting, but not the subject of tonight's meeting. And in 1964, I guess, was the first time I went to Southeast Asia. During the Gulf of Tonkin crisis, we launched from Tennessee and went to South Carolina and picked up stuff and flew to all the way to Hawaii and tried to rest and flew on to Eniwetok and on to Clark, and the next morning we were in Da Nang with a load of bombs and came home that night with a load of caskets. So that was 64, and I managed to go in and out many times over the course of the next 10 years. And my last trip into Saigon was in very late 74, very early 75. I spent a year signed at Ubon, Thailand, the Royal Thai Air Force Base, in AC-130 gunships, which was a very, very interesting year. Our mission there was to hunt trucks on the Ho Chi Minh Trail in Laos at night. And so that's how I did my one-year tour, but the rest of my trips to Southeast Asia, to Vietnam, were TDY status. It was a very interesting time. I was a captain, I was a first lieutenant the first time I went. I was a major the last time I went, and I was a captain during my one-year tour, and wound up a lieutenant colonel. So I guess that's the synopsis there.
Oh, thank you very much. Nick?
Well, I also joined the service in 1954. I went to the Air Force, and then in 1958 I went to the Marine Corps, and that's where I was, and I went to Vietnam. I volunteered to go to Vietnam. That was something we wanted to do, so I wanted to do it. I wanted to be over there where the action was. And I went over to Staff Sergeant, and I came back as Staff Sergeant in 1968. I went over to 67, and back in 68. I was supply chief, and I was also a door gunner on a Huey helicopter while I was there. So I had two functions.
Thank you. Al?
I'll stand up for this.
Okay. Yep, I'll see my dad here, okay?
I entered college in 1960, and even then we began to understand the thing for heating up. And I think my sense of patriotism suggested that it was important for me to serve my country. So I chose to go into advanced ROTC like Tim at University of Rhode Island. Upon graduation, I got my graduate degree and then worked for a while. I could have got a job deferment, the type of work I was doing. But in 66, I went down to Fort Knox with the Corps of Engineers, helped form an engineer battalion construction, and shift over in 67 to Vietnam. I had asked the Army to send me to Germany. I was not particularly anxious to go to Vietnam. But I did end up going. I spent a year over there during the Tet Offensive and this transition period. And it wasn't clear to me, as I think about it now, whether I felt we were winning or losing, but I suspect at the time I felt it was beginning to lose. I was stationed up in Cu Chi with the 25th Infantry Division as a engineer maintenance officer. And so I really wasn't involved in the combat role too much. I do remember the rockets coming down onto our base. And as we now read about the tunnels of Cu Chi, famous tunnels of Cu Chi, which we didn't know about then. Sort of an interesting place to be at the time. So I ended up as a lieutenant and retired as a lieutenant. Thank you. John.
Well, I wasn't drafted. I was in the Navy. I enlisted, went to Korea on a carrier, did a tour of Japan. Then I decided to make a career in the Navy. And I was in Boston in a shipyard in 64. Just as they were beginning to really heat up over there. And I had ordered to an admiral staff on an amphibious transport. I packed the family up in Boston the day after Christmas, took them to San Diego, and 10 days later I'm on my way to Vietnam on this troop transport. The Viet Cong had mined a aircraft carrier, a small one they used MSTS, the transport service, in Saigon Harbor and sunk it. Some fleet tugs had gone in with a repair ship refloated it. And when it was ready to be brought down, they sent us up the river to the Saigon to kind of show the flag and divert attention while they took the carrier downstream. And then I went to a helicopter outfit in San Diego, and I spent two tours in the Tonkin Gulf aboard the Bennington with a helicopter unit. Came back from that, got shoulder in Japan with the Admiral staff in charge of all of fleet air in the Pacific. We more or less did the planning for the Navy base at Camran Bay and the Navy unit at Da Nang. When that tour was up, I didn't want to go to Vietnam again, but they gave me orders to an 18-month tour in the Tonkin Gulf with the Admiral, who was in charge of all the carriers, and it was an 18-month tour considered in-country. During that 18 months, I had charge of all the classified material the staff had. Part of my job was conducting classified liaison business with other ships in the operating with us, which meant two or three times a week, I was on a helicopter, be cabled down on a hoist, go aboard this ship, do my business, come back an hour later, they come back to Hilo and pick me up. I also flew into Da Nang quite a few times on a prop driven plane. And after a while, it just got kind of boring. And I told the flag secretary about a month before I was to be relieved that I was tired of flying the helicopter. Something was going to happen, and the next one I didn't want to go up anymore, to let one of the young kids do it. And he said, okay. And a month later, I'm being transferred from back to the States. We were in the Philippines. It was a monsoon. Nothing had gone to Clark. The skipper of the Enterprise said, well, we'll put him on out my Hilo. I'm going to Poro Point, the munitions place. And after you drop me off, you take him to Clark. Once we got airborne in the Hilo, the monsoon came back in us, and we couldn't get to Poro Point. We tried to go to Clark, and we were up over a mountain pass, and there was a scrunch, scrunch, and everything stopped, and down we came. And I watched the skipper of the Enterprise, and I figured he's scared because he's an old aviator, and I'll be scared. Well, they got one engine going, and we began to just slowly come down and spiral down. And I had no idea where we were, and all of a sudden there was a snap and the blade broke. And we dropped, and we were 15 feet above a swamp. So we all sat there and waited until they came out with a rescue boat, and we were 550 feet from the end of the runway. That was done.
What rank did you get to be?
E6 at Yeoman. I started out as a machinist mate the first enlistment. I didn't like the engine room, so I changed over to administration.
Okay, that's good. That's money for the record. Okay, Errol.
I was Army, and in the winter of 67-68, I was doing Peace Corps training in Hawaii. Spent the winter on a big island near the volcanoes, learning Fijian. I was going to go to the Fiji Islands. And along about Christmas time, amongst my Christmas cards, I got a draft notice. In those days, you could be drafted out of the Peace Corps. It was up to your local draft board. And the folks in Portland, the draft board, said to me, what's Fiji? They had no idea what I was supposed to do. So the State Department that wanted me to go to Fiji and the Defense Department that wanted me in the Army argued about it, and eventually the Army won. So in lieu of being drafted, I enlisted. I went through basic training as a private E1 at Fort Dix, went through infantry training, infantry OCS at Fort Benning, and spent the summer and fall of 69 at Fort Lewis, Washington, and then advisory course training for MACV, which is the unit was assigned to advise the South Vietnamese Army, and language training at Fort Bragg in Fort Bliss, Texas. So that's how I got into the thing. In the course of 18 months, the Army taught me to speak two languages, which I no longer can speak in.
What were they languages?
Well, Fijian.
Yeah.
I was fluent in the language of the Fijian Islands, and also Vietnamese. Although once I got to Vietnam, I realized or was told that I had been taught the Hanoi dialect, not the
And as it happened, the all the people that I was advising wanted to speak English. They knew full well that they wanted to sell used cars in L.A. after the war. They would know English more than I have no Vietnamese. And I went over as a second lieutenant and came back as a first lieutenant.
Okay. Don?
Yep. I was in the Army. I enlisted through the ROTC program, and I spent 3 years in the Army, 2 years in Germany, and last year in Vietnam. That was 1968, February of 68, February of 69. And I started in the Army as a second lieutenant and came out as a captain.
Thanks. And Tim?
I mentioned that I was in the Army. I was ROTC. I was commissioned as a second lieutenant in 69, and then in 1970, before I went to Vietnam, I would have made first lieutenant. I served over there from September of 1970 to June of 71. It was a program, that was when the American forces were being drawn down, and they had a program where they said you could get out of the Army without incurring further obligation and go home from Vietnam, or you could stay over and I could have become a captain. It was a pretty easy choice. I decided to come home. It turned out that what they meant is I didn't incur more than 6 years of obligation, so I ended up spending four more years in the Army Reserve. One thing of interest that I brought along here somewhere that I've lost already. My orders, when I received my combat infantryman's badge in November of 1970, there's a list, alphabetical listing of people they underline your name. Later on, when Tiger Woods became famous, and they talked about his father and everything, and I thought, gee, that name sounds familiar. I dug out my orders, and the bottom one is Woods, Earl D., Lieutenant General Infantry. He was the province deputy senior advisor. I'd seen him a couple times at various times. He obviously wouldn't know me. We haven't corresponded, but so you do run into people that you
good
like to know.
Great. Thank you. I think some people covered the next question, but let's go back and see what those next three questions are. What years did you serve in Vietnam, and what areas of Vietnam were you stationed, and what capacity did you serve? I think most people covered that, but if somebody didn't speak up now, does anyone want to add anything to that? Errol, do you want to add anything to your own?
Yes.
I
didn't say. I volunteered in December of 66, and I got about a few days after Christmas, I got notification that I was to be in Nellis Air Force Base for regional training in February, and I went to there 6 weeks of training in the F-105, and I went to Southeast Asia in early April. I was stationed in Thailand, and I flew 100 missions over North Vietnam, and finished up, this was April of 67, I finished up just before Thanksgiving. I got home for Thanksgiving there, because I Air Force policy, if you survive the 100 missions over North Vietnam, they let you come home or give you a transfer back to the States.
Thanks. Anybody else? Errol?
I arrived in Vietnam on the 1st of March in 1970 and left on Washington's birthday in 71. I was in extreme southwestern Vietnam. Here on this map, this is the south end of Vietnam, the Delta. I was stationed in this province from Cambodia down to what is known as the U Minh Forest, and also spent a tour out on Phu Quoc Island, which is due south of the Elephant Mountains of Cambodia.
Okay. Anybody else got anything to answer about those edge of those? Let's move on then to the fun stuff here. Let's see. Or maybe the more interesting stuff, maybe sometimes. Can you describe one memory of the experience of your experience in Vietnam? Is anybody have a memory they'd like to start off with? Well, anybody who wants to be first on this one? Al, do you want to be first?
Sure. In traveling between Cu Chi and Saigon, we go through the rice paddies, and the peasants would be there harvesting the rice. And I still remember, though, because then and now I kind of starting at 45 in a turmoil war. And these people were at the mercy of the political whims. And they just wanted peace. They wanted us to leave. They wanted to continue to live a normal life. And I think that's the memory I have then and now of these people that were just caught up in a war that they didn't really want. Thank you.
Anybody else got a memory they want? Errol?
No. On the 31st of March in 1970, again, I was on the little mountaintop here, and there was a great storm, and there were maybe patrol boats, swift boats, they now know. I didn't know at the time that's what they were called. It was floundering off the coast. There was a MAT team, such as was described earlier up here, that was under attack. And there were several other things going on. And I spent the night in relative safety on top of this mountain, but I was doing radio traffic, arranging for medevacs and coordinating with Province Capital and the Navy and so forth. And the next morning when the sun came up, everything quieted down. And I think anybody here who's been over there would know that sunrise in Vietnam was always the best part of the day because the action at least slowed down, it didn't stop. So I remember that. And that particular Sunday morning when the sun came up was Easter.
Okay. Anybody else got it? No.
Well, he just reminded me of a particular evening. Most, as I said, when I was in AC-130, most of the time we hunted trucks on the Ho Chi Minh Trail. But there were a few occasions when we went to support road watch teams in Laos, and I was on a mission one night particularly, and he reminded me of that just now when there was a small road watch team, and they were surrounded and under attack, and I was talking to them on the radio, and you could hear them, you could hear all the shooting going on, and unfortunately, he didn't, the fellow that I was talking to on the ground, I don't think understood that we were in an airplane that the guns fired out the left side, not out front, so he could hear us, but he didn't understand how we were working, but there were several times when he would just key the mic and whisper, shoot, 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 and we would just roll in and hose the ground, and create as much noise and fire as we could, and hopefully keep the bad guys down. And we stayed with them until we were almost running on fumes, and there was not another airplane to follow behind us. But we were fortunate to, when we learned the next morning that they were able to extract them. But I remembered that night when you were talking about being on the radio, and it sticks with you.
Anybody else have any favorite?
Yeah, I had kind of a funny experience. I think about it a lot now. At the time, it happened. It kind of scared me, but I was in a gun room one night. When you get in the aircraft, you have to get all your equipment ready, put on your life jacket, your helmet, check out your radios and everything. And you had a line that you hooked to the bottom of the aircraft, and it hooked on you. You had a harness you put over your vest. So we had a black jacket, and you hooked it on, and you had a safety pin going through it. You always checked that. And because if you got shot while you're standing in the door, you're going to fall out of the aircraft. And that would hold you. That you wouldn't go to the ground. And we had, on the Huey helicopter, we had rocket pods on the side. Sometimes the pilot could fire, electronically, but sometimes they malfunction. So you had to crawl out there on the skid, get down on the back of the rocket pod there and set it manually. So within a gun run one night, it happened. It didn't fire. So I'm out there, happy go lucky. We're rolling in, and I'm setting the selector on the pod to get back into the aircraft. As soon as I do it, the first thing I do is check to see if I got my safety line on. Well, it wasn't on.
Okay, that's
didn't have it on.
Why? Yeah, that's a good one. Anybody else got anything? Let's go on to the next. Let's move on to the next question. What was your opinion of the Viet Cong? Anybody have any response to that?
They were terrorists.
Okay.
I felt that they were just tools of the North Vietnamese.
Okay.
And that was borne out by the fact that after the peace talks, their representative, Madam Bin, just disappeared from the newscast and everything else. When they took over, the Viet Cong were dispensed with, and it was strictly North Vietnamese.
Okay. Anybody else got any comments about the Viet Cong? Okay, let's move on then to how did the various changes in the execution of war strategies affect you? Do you see any indication of how the administrations, there were three administrations, I guess, basically, involved with the war? How did anyone, you want to?
Well, because Robert McNamara was Secretary of Defense, and he was a lot like Rumsfeld, reminds me a lot of it. He ran the military with an iron hand, and he knew more than all these generals that had been in service for 30 years, 30 some years. He knew more than they did, and everything had to be his way. We were bombing North Vietnam, and we were allowed to hit bridges and railroad yards and things like that. But the good targets were all selected by the President and the Secretary of Defense. We couldn't even bomb airplanes on the ground when I first went over there at Kep Airfield and Phuket Airfield. They had all their MiG-21s were at Phuket, which was just north of Hanoi. We could fly by and see MiG-21s on the ground. We weren't allowed to hit them until about July of 67. And you know, McNamara and the boys in Washington decided, well, it was all right to bomb airplanes on the ground and things like that. And it just grated on guys that, you know, we ended up flying a circuit of targets. There were railroad yards where the railroad, the choke points or railroad intersections or big rail yards where there'd be a lot of rolling stock. And we'd go around on Monday, we'd hit the Northeast Railroad, and maybe Tuesday we'd hit the Northwest Railroad, and maybe Wednesday we'd hit the railroads in just outside Hanoi. And you know, and then there'd be a couple of bad weather days when the other guys would get to fly the easy targets down south where the weather was okay. But they canceled out. We guys that were, our job was to go up to missile sites. And so most of our missions were up north where most of the missile sites were. And as the war went on, you know, later on after I was there just a few months, they finally let us bombed the big bridge that went into downtown Hanoi. There's a bridge, the Paul Duman Bridge. It was a combination railroad and road bridge. It was over there, and the road was on top, I think, and the railroad ran underneath. The bridge was a mile long across one of the rivers into Hanoi. They finally let us bomb that. And after this had been going on for, it seemed like a long time, still, when you fly north of Hanoi, between Hanoi and the Chinese border, there were always trucks and everything on the road. You go down in southern North Vietnam, and we were able to keep them off the roads most of the time during the day. You seldom saw vehicles on the road. But up north, from China down to Hanoi, there was always truck traffic, and it was just so far away. We couldn't get there without a big production where you had to have tankers and air refueling and all this and you know, put together a package where it just was very inefficient what we were doing, and it was pretty obvious that we weren't really doing serious damage.
Thank you. Paul?
One of the features of that particular time frame, I think, was that we were in one respect at a technologically awkward age, where communications had progressed to the point where Lyndon Johnson bragged that we couldn't hit an outhouse without his okay. So communications were at the point where they could micromanage the war, but they weren't good enough yet where they could get all the information back to know what was really happening on the ground. So Washington micromanaged the war with all kinds of absolutely absurd rules of engagement. And they didn't know what they were doing, and they didn't know what the situation was there. Nowadays, our doctrine has improved, and we let the battlefield commanders command the battlefield, but we can still get that real-time intelligence back because it goes through a satellite and all that. But I think that was a technologically awkward age, and we paid for it with a lot of lives.
Okay. Anybody else have any comments about the execution of the war?
I was there at the beginning of, well, actually the withdrawal, the Vietnamization had already begun. But when I arrived in Tansanut, I stepped off the plane and there was great applause. And what I found out later was that they were applauding the plane behind me that was going to take them home, not me. I waited a year to have that same experience and the plane came in empty. So fortunately, it went up with a full load. And there were great swaths of the Delta that were being turned over during my tour. Things that were strictly American bases were suddenly turned over to the Vietnamese. So we were within full withdrawal.
Anybody else on that question? Okay, let's move on then to the next one. How aware were you of the peace forces while you were in the service? How aware were you? Very aware of the peace forces? Anybody want to tangle that one? Tangle with that one?
I will mention the fact that during the Cambodian incursion, I was in Cambodia, and I agreed fully with the exercise. The media, however, back here treated it as though the United States had violated the sovereignty and neutrality of Cambodia, when in fact most of the section of Cambodia along the border had been pretty well taken over by the NVA. They had already violated the sovereignty. In my role as a communicator on the mountaintop, retransmitting broadcasts, I spent one whole night broadcasting to the province capital reports out of Cambodia about the hundreds of tons of ammunition, weapons, and materiel that had been captured and destroyed. And that to me was should have been applauded by people who didn't like war.
Okay, anybody else got anything? Move on then to the next question. How did the peace movement affect your attitudes toward your service? A little different spin on that question. Does that have any bearing on your idea of your service?
When your life is like Rich and I were, no, it doesn't affect you because you're going to stay anyway.
Okay.
Yep. It's safer in than okay. It is out.
Okay. Anybody else got any?
Well, when I got back here, I let my hair grow long, and then I thought I missed the uniform. I got back into the reserve, spent another 28 years in the service, so there was no effect on staying with it.
Okay. Yeah, I think, it had an effect on me. It pissed me off at the time. And I was stationed at PACAP, in Hawaii during the 1971 to 76 time frame, toward the end of the war. And some idiots came on the base at Hickam, and they got into, I think they were confused about what electronic warfare officers did, and they went into PACAP headquarters where the electronic warfare shop was, and opened a couple of file drawers and poured a bunch of blood into these classified file drawers. And I don't remember how they got in there, but some of the guys kind of roughed them up once they saw what they were doing. It made you feel bad. When I came back from Vietnam in November of 67, I flew into Chicago, and we were advised not to wear any uniforms away from the bases, and in Washington, D.C., people stationed there when I was down in Virginia, you didn't wear uniforms away from the Pentagon. A lot of the people that worked in the Pentagon didn't even wear their uniforms because of the protest. And that hurt. It really did.
Anybody else got anything to say?
Well, when we came back from Clark Air Base out of Vietnam, and we flew into Travis to come home on leave, and we were required to change the civilian clothes before we left Travis to get down to San Francisco and fly east. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Anybody else got anything on that paper?
I have to admit that I agree with most of it, but there were these little spots of bright light. I came back from now, and stewardesses on American Airlines at least, and probably others, recognize a skinny kid with a tan in the middle of winter with a uniform as someone who's back, and we were treated very well.
Okay. Anything else? Okay.
I came back in 68, and even then the peace movement was underway. I have to admit, into the mid-70s, I was becoming part of that peace movement. I wondered, why the dickens were we over there? And maybe it was time to pick it up. So that's, I think I was doing the right thing at the time, but I really had some doubts about why the United States was over there.
Okay. Anybody else, any other questions? Let's move on then to the next question is, how did you perceive the roles of Lyndon Johnson, Richard Nixon, or Gerald Ford in the war? Anybody have any comments on those three presidents? They were the three presidents that were most involved with the Vietnam War. Anybody have any comment on any of those three presidents? Yeah, we've already heard something about Johnson, but anything more? Richard Nixon?
I don't think I better say any more about
Gerald Ford?
I'll second the notion about Johnson. I think he and his administration micromanaged the war. And even when they knew better, they pursued it the way they had started it. Even after the truth became known, they compounded the error by continuing to do the same thing rather than change strategy. I was drafted, if you will, and enlisted under Johnson, but left under, came back home after Nixon took over, and his Vietnamization didn't go exactly the way it was promised. Obviously it didn't. But I think it was the only policy at the time that could have happened.
Okay. Anybody else?
I there's no doubt from what I read, I think if Kennedy hadn't got assassinated, I don't think we would have gotten involved in Vietnam. I think he wanted to get out of Vietnam. He could see the handwriting on the wall. And I don't know why Lyndon Johnson thought they should escalate it like they did, but they did.
Yeah.
I don't think Johnson knew much about Vietnam. I mean, from what I know, that Johnson pretty much inherited Kennedy's advisors, and so he was basically listening to them. And from what I've read, they were pretty much running the show, and Johnson was deathly afraid of looking bad. He was deathly afraid of two things. On one hand, starting World War III by bombing too close to the Chinese border or getting Soviets involved, and at the same time, he was deathly afraid if Vietnam goes communist, then, he looks terrible. So, he, I don't think he himself, being from Texas, he was, his background and expertise was all in domestic politics, and he basically inherited a lot of Kennedy's brain trust, and I think listening to them, and saw where that goes.
I think he didn't want to lose a war, though. That was one of his overriding thoughts. He thought he might lose a war, and I think that was one of the things that really caused him to be so.
I think I paraphrase the strategy as trying to bomb them into submission without making them angry.
Yeah.
That's the way it looked to some of us.
Okay, that's
at the other end, of course, American administrations were assuming that we had an ally in South Vietnam that was A, competent, and B, willing to win, and neither of those was the case. It was corrupt from the beginning.
Okay, anybody else? Let's move then to the next question, which is, how did you feel unappreciated for your service in the war when you came home? Anybody have any comment on that? Is that one of the common comments made about service in Vietnam? Who felt unappreciated when they came home? World War II, they had lots of parades and festivities, and in Vietnam, there wasn't much of anything in many cases. Does anybody have any comment about that?
Yes,
okay. But do you have any other further comment about it, or just a... Just yes and not
no. I mean, it's almost urban myth that people would call baby killers and so forth. Well, at LaGuardia, I was. And talk about wearing a uniform and so forth. It,
I wore my uniform. I earned the right to wear it, and I did wear it. And I will say, when I got home, people here were real, they weren't abusive.
Supportive.
They were very supportive. I never ran into one around here that wasn't supportive.
Okay. Anybody else on that comment? Okay, let's go to the next one then. What effect has the Vietnam Memorial in Washington, D.C. had upon you? Probably all of you have been there. Anybody got a comment about that? It's one of the most moving experiences, I think, of any monument I've ever been to. It's to see it.
No, you said it right there.
Yeah, it is. And I went to see, I actually photographed James Bartlett and Ron Smiley's names on the book. I wanted to do that, so I have them for the archives here. So, but anybody got any comments about it?
Brought tears to my eyes.
Yeah, it's incredible, isn't it?
If I might, I'd like to read something on that.
Yeah.
This is, I kept a journal for many years. I guess I still do. And in September of 84, I said, "This afternoon I drove to Washington to visit the Vietnam Memorial. It was a sobering experience. When I arrived, small groups of people were filing past the thousands of names, the curious, the relatives, and the survivors. I looked up Ronnie St. John, panel 10E, line 104. Colonel Ellison, panel 5. Line 111. Captain Bush, whose POW MIE bracelet I wore, is also listed. I confessed that beforehand I wanted to feel emotion while there and feared I would not. The war has played such a singular role in my life, and it would have seemed like a betrayal to have remained unmoved. As it was, I had tears in my eyes even before I got there, and several times while there as well. One wonders how the place will be regarded as the parents of the falling men grow old and pass on, as our generation too grows older and memory fails. Will it still have the same effect? Will people still come with flowers and flags, still pause to read the row after row after row of names and have tears well up in their eyes? I suppose not. And after a few decades, it will be just an interesting pattern made up of 58,000 carefully carved names on black granite, of men and women who fell in some long ago forgotten war. In truth, as long as warriors anywhere battle, a kinship will remain. While others may forget, the soldiers won't. Whether the names belong to the troops of Alexander at Issus, Lee at Gettysburg, or Colonel Ellison 134 miles southwest of Saigon, the Brotherhood of Arms remains. The peace that pervades the memorial ground belies the terrible places where all those people died, terrible muddy places with fire, smoke, and deafening noise, quiet canals where a sudden ambush ended it all, in paddies, in temples, on fire bases, airfields, or at woodlines along dikes, and on mountaintops, and helicopters falling clumsily from the sky. There were deaths suffered all alone or in a buddy's arms, in acts of heroism or cut down without knowing, but death nonetheless. I suppose there are 58,000 tombstones scattered around the nation, duplicating the names at the memorial, and each one sacred. For me, however, seeing them all there, from beginning to end, makes the memorial at Washington the true emotional center of my memories of the war."
Thank you. Anybody else got anything to say?
Well, even the miniature wall that go around the country, are very moving just to visit those. Mm-hmm. Very moving.
This, in fact, was part of the speech I gave at Augusta when it was up there.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody else? Okay. Then move on to the final question. What do you believe are some of the legacies of the Vietnam War upon the history of the United States? Anybody got an idea about the legacy of this war, or what we should remember about it, or why it's an important lesson? Anybody got anything on that? Yes, Richard?
I think the best thing that came out of Vietnam was a lot of people in the military learned how not to fight a war, and the tragedy of that war was that we were fighting because we were afraid to lose. We weren't fighting to. We didn't have the courage. The national leadership didn't have the courage to do what it took to win, but they couldn't bear to lose, and that's why it dragged on for so long. And so, unfortunately, it ended up getting so many more people killed than needed to be. And people like Colin Powell, Norman Schwarzkopf, a guy named Chuck Horner, the people that survived how the war was badly fought in Vietnam, learned how to fight a war and how to win one in a hurry in Iraq. The lesson being, I think, that war is never good, but the most humane way to fight one is to fight it as hard as you can and get it over as quickly as you can, and you end up with fewer people getting killed on both sides to do that.
I concur with the speaker earlier who said that it was essentially part of the Cold War. This is a 12-year stretch when we, if you will, held back some of the Soviet Union's designs by having them pour as much treasure in as we did. Obviously, they didn't lose the lives, but it was one of the battles of the Cold War, and I think history will record it as such.
Any other legacy comments about?
I think one lesson that we as a nation have learned, though, I think we as citizens have been able to separate the war from the service of the servicemen. The war in Iraq is very, very unpopular with many, many people right now. But I think most Americans are now able to make the distinction between those who are serving and the politics of the war itself. And I guess that's pretty important. I mean, it is to me.
Mm-hmm. Any other comment about legacies?
The only thing I'd like to say, I noticed now the reporting on the war in Iraq. And I know when I came back to Vietnam, the reporting is not the same as what's going on. That's why the people here get the wrong impression of the war and what's going on. There's a lot of good happening in Iraq right now, too, but it's not being reported. Those are the things that the news media has to stop being so biased. The truth has to be gotten out to everybody.
Okay, anybody else?
And I think, Norm, you mentioned technology, and I work for a company that worked for the Pentagon developing electronic technologies to support the Vietnam War. And I think it began the trend toward moving people further away from the actual combat, that the technologies permitted one to fight the war at a distance. And we're seeing that in Iraq, certainly, to some extent.
That's true. Technology has a lot to do with it, but technology doesn't defeat people who are willing to die for a mission. We had all the McNamara's electronic fence in Laos trying to keep the North Vietnamese from coming down through the jungles. Well, those people, they could take a sack of rice and 100 pounds of ammunition and a water buffalo or something, and they could survive in the jungle, and McNamara's electronic fence be damned. They were going to be there. The terrorists in Iraq. We've got all these wondrous devices. We can drop a 2,000-pound bomb down a chimney, but you can't find all those terrorists who are willing to give their life for what they believe. You've still got technology can't do it all.
But I think the nature of the war is also changing.
I agree.
The war is becoming more insurgent, terrorist oriented.
I agree, but the technology by itself can't
do it.
There are two items, speaking of technology. On our mountaintop in the south end of Vietnam, we had an IOS, Integrated Observational System. It was about the size of a Volkswagen, and it had this wonderful thing called a laser. And it could give you the range targets, five targets at once. There were two of these things in country, one on a mountaintop, one up at the DMZ. And this thing was so technical that if you broke the knob off it, the first line of maintenance was back in the States. The whole thing had to be shipped back here and repaired. You can get the same technology at a hardware store to measure the length of a room. So that technology was developed during Vietnam and is now being used. Also, the basis for which FedEx is based on the distribution system that was used in Vietnam. He just brought it back here and duplicated it with central hubs and so forth. So those are two things that, among many, that were developed in during the war that we take for granted now.
Any other final comments? Why don't we go to the audience? Anybody in the audience have any questions or comments? Brad, do you have anything further to ask?
I'm just curious, most of you guys were from this area, and I'm curious, when in service, did you encounter large differences with, served obviously with people from all over the country? Was that something that was one of the highlights of being in service? Do you think that people from this part of Maine were in service quite different than some other folks from different parts of the country?
Well, I, in my engineer battalion, which was formed up in Fort Knox, Kentucky, many of the soldiers came from the hills of Kentucky, that area. And there was a different group of people than what I had encountered before. But they learned a livelihood. Out of a bulldozer, and so it got that problem.
I thought it certainly added a lot of variety to have a group of 20, 30 people working together, and then from Hawaii and Chicago and the suburbs of New York, and the Deep South, the Ozarks. Yeah. Everybody would read everyone else's hometown paper. I got the Bridgeton News, and someone else got the Walnut Arkansas Gazette or something, and there was a lot of trading.
They were always there for care package.
Yes, sir. Yes.
The yep. Funny thing happens though when a bunch of guys go through training together and they all these experiences, it doesn't matter much what part of the country you're from. You're all in this together, and we talked different. I took my share of resin because of the way I packed my car and stuff like that. That's the thing that bothers me about our society today. In the service, you can josh, you can kid the other guys with resin, crap out of them because of the way they talk or the way they do something or whatever. But in society, you can't denigrate a person because he talks like an Italian or a Polack, or you can't tell Polish jokes or jokes about people of a different color or something like that, because it's not allowed anymore, and that I think it's divisive.
I think military service is a great lesson in how to get along with people and how to work with people. And of all the stuff that I came away with after 21 years of service, I think that's one of the most valuable things. I mean, after all, I'm from Texas, and I married a girl from Bethel, so.
Anybody, any other final?
Yeah, I guess one other question for each of you, what would be the one thing that you'd suggest for me as a teacher of high school kids, one thing about Vietnam that you'd like me to mention to them, every year I teach American history to a new set of 16-year-olds, and this is actually, I think, the first time I've met Vietnam veterans, so, I've taught the war for a number of years, but, this spring when I teach it, I can share some thoughts of some veterans with them, and just some...
The textbook thought that comes to my mind is that after I was over there and saw that we weren't doing much to really win the war,
it came to mind that we were fighting, the reason we didn't win was we were fighting the Vietnamese George Washington. Ho Chi Minh had enabled the Vietnamese to throw off the yoke of French colonialism that had been going on for so many years. He was a national hero, even though, you know, he caused untold thousands of his own people to die. He was still their national hero and their first president, you know. And so that's a big reason why we didn't.
Anybody else got an answer?
There was a joke that went around about that time that was about the guy that was in the hospital recovering from his wounds. And they said, well, what happened to you? He said, well, I was on patrol one night and I heard someone just across the path and I didn't know who it was. And I yelled, Ho Chi Minh's an SOB. And he yelled back, LBJ's an SOB. And while we were shaking hands, a tank ran over. Well, that was it.
American Revolution, and you know, if you, I've read a little bit about that, I'm sure you have it, but we were behind, but we eventually defeated the British. Well, I was a medic in the 25th Infantry Division, and we treated a lot of Vietnamese, including Viet Cong, wounded, and it gave me some insight, and we used to always check new men in replacements when they came in. And if there was one of these prisoners available, and there often was, I'd try to get the new guys, they would come in for the medical unit, check their teeth and whatever, to come take a look at one of these Viet Cong prisoners, because they usually were under 100 pounds. I think 60% of them had tuberculosis. They were malnourished. They had parasitic diseases. Internal parasitic diseases, oftentimes terrible fungal infection. And they had problems with their teeth, believe it or not. I think because they ate more of the American rations and sugar and all that business. But I used to point it out because I was an observer, and a medic sees more dead and wounded maybe than even an infantryman. But I used to point out to them that that's the enemy, and they're beating us. They were determined, we were on their ground. It's a lesson that I'm not sure that the military has learned yet. We're in a kind of a situation in Iraq now, and it's going to be hard to win when you have determined people on their home ground. It's a lesson in history that people don't seem to catch.
I think a lot of misconceptions are based on the histories that are being written by people who had preconceived notions way back. There are a lot of books out there that are, I think, misleading. I don't know what the history texts that are published say. I've not seen any of them. But chances are they're written by people who, some of them would have cheered with the other side.
Well, it is interesting in the historiography about the war over the last 10 or 20 years, there has been a new, more revisionist interpretation of the war, which basically says the military could have won the war on the ground if the political leaders let them do it. And we've kind of heard some of you guys say that tonight. And so, you know, there are different schools of thought among historians on that. I think in the 10 or 20 years right after the war, much of the history of U.S. involvement is pretty negative, but more recently there's been, you know, there have been new perspectives on it.
Anybody else got it? Yeah.
Well, I guess I'd like to applaud you for introducing the Vietnam into your commercial.
Well, it's not like it's a joke. I mean, it's an important part of our history.
Well, it is. But I think a lot of us don't talk about it anymore. I know when I first came to Bethel, Don and I struck up a relationship and started talking about our experiences. When Stan first mentioned putting this program together tonight, you know, it had a good ring because people don't talk about Vietnam much.
Are there any books?
It seemed long ago and a forgotten war to many of us. kind of put us in the back shelf.
One thing that students do enjoy, particularly in English classes, there's a number of novels about the war that students have read. Mac Davis has a course on warfare, man in war, it's called something like that. They read a number of novels about the war that students enjoy quite a bit. Are there any in particular that you guys have read or that you recommend? Tim O'Brien is one of the authors of a lot of the
Rumors of War.
Rumors of War.
Lionheads. And if you want, I think, a universal experience of soldiers, is you can't be all quiet on the Eastern Front, Western Front, or World War I. This is relevant today as it was then. One book that is certainly fascinating, and that is In Love and in War, James Stockdale. That's an old book, and I have a paperback copy that's coming apart. If you're familiar with him, he was shot down early in the war. It's a Navy firefighter shot down early in the war. Was tortured, and ultimately, after he was released, after about 6.5 years, I think it was.
Yeah, he was a senior ranking.
He was a senior ranking POW who won the Medal of Honor for his conduct in captivity. It ought to be required reading for high school students. It really tells it like it is. I don't know how it is because I was lucky. I didn't get captured. But
what was the title of that again?
I think it's In Love and in War. I believe it.
But James Stockdale. I can't remember the title, but he wrote an excellent book on their experiences of the POWs. And he had a doctorate in philosophy even before he was captured. And apparently he had some interesting discussions. He knew more about Ho Chi Minh and Lenin than his communist captors. He's extremely well, effective writer for that subject.
Dick, do you have a question?
Yeah, there's a book called When Thunder Roared. I think that's the title of it. It's a true story, not a novel, written by Air Force pilot, flying out of Thailand, I believe it was, into Vietnam every day. That's one of the best, flying stories about the real world of fighter pilots and air-to-ground support pilots. And how that operation all worked, if you're interested in that one. It's a very interesting book. I've forgotten the name of the author. I can get it for you, though. I believe the title was When Thunder Roared.
There's another one called Steel Tiger. There's a former Air Force pilot that wrote a couple of those novels around that, and they're very, very accurate. I mean, I was reading this one, and he was describing Roger Wamsley, the tailor, the Indian tailor, right outside the gate at Ubon. I said, yeah, I've been there. I got some clothes that I bought there. So, the details were really, really good.
Okay, anybody else have anything to offer? Yeah, one more.
Perhaps the only one here, or maybe one of the few here that was related to the Korean War. Do any of you have any comments about the association between the Korean War and the Vietnam War? Now, we didn't win the Korean War either. We didn't fight it to win it. Do any of you have anything to say about that relationship?
I'll repeat what I said earlier. Both of these were part of the Cold War.
Yeah.
And ages from now, it will be looked upon as there was a battle there and a battle there, and eventually the Soviet Union collapsed and China opened up or whatever.
Yeah, perhaps.
Yeah. I'm afraid Korea may not be over, unfortunately.
I don't think so.
One thing I'll say about that, Nick, is not related to the big policy, but most of the NCOs in my company in Vietnam were Korean War veterans. They were ending up their 20-year tours.
Mm.
And it was great to have them because they were experienced, combat experience, Division, 25th Division, was made up of men who had been in the service for less than 2 years when I was there. Mm-hmm. So those guys were really the backbone and good experience. The unfortunate thing is some of them, you know, with 18, 19 years of service, never made it to the 20th year.
Yeah.
But they really were a strong part of the Army that probably weren't recognized, but we recognized it.
Yeah. It seems to me we learned how not to win a war in the Korean War, and then we did it again in Vietnam. And that's the political relationship to the war.
We had three different air wars in Vietnam. You had the Navy. They divided North Vietnam up into sections.
Yeah.
The Navy flew into certain areas. The Air Force flew into different areas. We didn't really cooperate very well. That was kind of one war up there. And then you had the in-country war in South Vietnam. We weren't allowed to fly out of Thailand into South Vietnam because we didn't know where the good guys and the bad guys were. That was run by Mac B out of Saigon. Our war in northern Vietnam was run out of Saigon by a general that just worried about 7th Air Force. And then you had another war, air war going on in Laos that nobody knew about.
Yeah, this book I mentioned deals a little bit with that. Yeah, these guys they had certain targets that they were assigned. Here was another very right target over here, but that was the Navy's. We couldn't hit that one.
Right.
Yeah.
That made my job pretty tough out there in the Tonkin Gulf because my pilots couldn't hit your targets.
Yeah.
You couldn't hit my targets, and every week we were getting this stack of paper by AFCOS telling us we have to change our targets. So I've got my books and targets, get it changed. Just get it changed, change again.
And of course, every time you prepared a chart to go out and fly, you had dozens and dozens of little red boxes that you put on there with your grease pencil, because that's the place you can't shoot there, and you can't shoot there, and you can't shoot there. But at the other extreme, I was running a medevac out of this Phu Quoc Island, southwestern part, and we were on a airfield built of the Japanese. We had a U.S. Navy destroyer offshore guiding a plane from the Royal Thai Air Force into our base to take out some injured people. And I don't know how it happened, how it all transpired.
Okay, why don't we wind down, and I want to thank all these 8 panelists. Wonderful job tonight. That we just hit the surface. I don't think we've covered a lot, everything we could talk about, obviously. But I think it's been a beginning. I don't think anyone's ever done this sort of thing in any strokes like I know in the area. So I think we've sort of a pioneering effort here tonight. And would the people that are on this side, since the American flags over here, I'd like to get you to stand behind these people so I can take some photographs. And then everybody stay around, and hopefully the panel will stay around too. If anybody has any additional comments or additional, wants to look at some of the displays or hear a little more about these things. And I'll get these people photographed, and then we'll let you have Cyber Donuts. We have Cyber Donuts afterwards, so just stick around a little bit later. We'll adjourn at this time, and everybody come over here that's on this side, and we'll go from there. Thank you very much. Okay.
I couldn't get
it. 11 of us. High tech.